Welcome back to my finished basement. I'm Pat. This is Ground Zero Salem. It is Monday. You know the usual deal with Mondays with me. I got to go to work in an hour. Story of my life. But I was going to actually shoot this right after I did the last one, the cassette update. Kind of ran out of steam. Got distracted by something shiny, whatever. And it's kind of a good thing that I did, because I had a stack of LPs that I've been meaning to talk about, stuff that I've acquired over the past couple of months. And after kind of revisiting that, I realized that I had some CDs to talk about as well. We're listening to, before I go any further, we're listening to Doctor and the Crippins, Fired from the Circus. Very fucking cool record. Came out in the late 80s, mid to late 80s out of the UK. I've been binging heavily on UK hardcore. Noteworthy stuff like Heresy, Ripcord, the scene that Extreme Noise Terror and Napalm Death and Doom came out of as well. Just this really interesting time where, you know, a national scene kind of absorbed influences from the outside and came up with something really fresh and exciting. Everything from like straight edge bands to the birth of grindcore came out of it. It's just a fascinating scene with a lot of good bands. So I've been buying up some cheaper records, and I'm gonna do a dedicated update soon. But I was very chuffed, if you will, getting that in the mail today, and I'm spinning it down here. Came with a CD. The vinyl isn't playing right now. CD with everything on both the LPs. Really like that. It's just a classy move. Download card, we'll get you a CD. Classy. I have some CDs that I picked up as well. Just kind of floated into my life outside of the whole UK hardcore binge I've been on. I'm going to talk about them as well as a stack of LPs. First up, picked this up at Newbury Comics just last week. Over the weekend, actually, come to think of it. New Possessed, Revelations of Oblivion. I'm a latecomer to talking about this. People with metal channels on YouTube talked about it ad nauseum. I'm not sure what I have to add about that, about the album itself, other than I love it. I think it's really good. In my summation, it's probably the best way to go about doing a reunion record, particularly one with one original member. Reunion records can really go south in so many ways. There's, of course, the type of reunion record where the band gets back together, particularly with metal bands, that tries to inject like modern influences. It happened a lot in the 90s and the 2000s with like groove elements and stuff like that with thrash bands and death metal bands, and it just didn't work. More recently, I've seen a lot of like kind of examples of stuff like Defecation and Terrorizer, where the members are trying to emulate like an older sound, and it just doesn't work, in my opinion. You know, very modern, sterile production, and the songwriting just isn't as good as the classic stuff, which is, I mean, that's a heavy order to fill, of course, with those two bands. But Possessed, it's an original member, Jeff Becerra, and his new backing band with members of Sadistic Intent, and I love this song. Sadistic Intent, Coffin Text, etc., and they're huge fans of Possessed and honoring the songwriting style, you know, cribbing some key elements of what made those first three records great and kind of doing their own spin with the frontman, who is belting out a great vocal performance, not sounding exactly like he did back in the day, doesn't have that reverbed out kind of thing. They're not trying to do a retro 80s sort of production job. It's Peter Tagdrink produced, but he does it very tastefully, which I appreciate. There's rototoms all over it. Some of the songwriting is pretty, pretty traditional, but it does have that sort of Seven Churches weirdness to it in parts, and almost these kind of weird, like, Baroque, like, trem-picked riffs, which I love. It's just good. It's really, really good. If you haven't checked it out or you've been hesitant because it's a reunion record, get it. It's great. Next up, haven't spun this enough, but I've listened to this band plenty over the years. This is the Lethargy discography of their demos from 93 to 99. Lethargy was a Rochester, New York band that were around in the 90s. They were around when I lived briefly in Rochester for under a year, and they were always really impressive live. Started as sort of a technical death metal band with, like, not really death metal vocals, maybe more of a hardcore vocal approach, and just developed into this weird, ugly, chaotic, noisy, and technical type of music that a lot of people compared to Dillinger at the time. There were sort of more weird elements, almost like discordance axis going on. They were a very cool, innovative band and never really seemed to get talked about, which is wild because half of the band went on to form Mastodon right after they were the backing band for Today Is the Day and I think In the Eyes of God. So if you could track this down, good luck. I was lucky enough that regular commenter and Facebook friend Andrew found this at Half Price Books and traded me because he wasn't really into it. But yeah, big part of just my history growing up in upstate New York. Cool, influential band. Really, really great. Mortiskald, Dying Remains, early 90s, Milwaukee, Wisconsin, death metal. You know, I overuse adjectives all the time. You know, try not to be one of those people, but it is chunky as fuck. Definitely more on the mid-pace side with the typical bursts of speed you'd expect from that kind of era of death metal, but very well written. You know, it's very catchy. This came out on Peaceville. Great stuff. 108, hardcore band that I was around for, saw at least two or three times, and never really got into until now. I don't know why. It's probably because when they were really enjoying all their success during their heyday, during the very late 90s, I was listening to stuff like Ausrotten and The Pissed and was kind of done with metallic hardcore for a while. And I've revisited them since several times, and something never clicked until I got this discography, early discography, Creation, Sustenance, Destruction. Yeah, they're clearly a hardcore band of the era. They have enough fast in them to be hardcore in their songwriting, but there's this weird deconstructing, smashing, heavy slowness to them, and very, very believable, impassioned, angry vocals. They were Hare Krishnas, part of a very small sub-scene at the time with Shelter and Baby Gopal and a few others that were into Krishna consciousness. And their spirituality actually translates really well to their lyrics about, you know, materialism and consumerism and, you know, the sort of temporary nature of humanity. It actually works really well. You know, I'm not a religious or even really spiritual guy myself, but I like the way they put that into their music. Threefold Misery, Rager, you know, and it's, they do metal meshed with hardcore in a way that is really unique unto itself. You know, maybe you get kind of close with Dead Guy with a sort of chaotic thing, but man, 108 were great, and I completely took them for granted, even though I saw them like two or three times, just didn't get it, didn't care. Another Nuabum record, as I kind of gingerly explore stuff I might like out of the five or six bands that I've been into for forever. Tigers of Pantang, Spellbound. Little research revealed to me that this was probably the record to get because it has Gangland on it, which Creator covered on Out of the Dark Into the Light. I always love that track. That track smokes. Like a lot of new wave of British heavy metal stuff that I do like, with Saxon and Raven and all that, there's the fast, like, kind of pounding heavy metal songs that I really dig, and then there's the mid-paced, anthemic, more Van Halen, early Van Halen or AC/DC kind of sounding stuff that I just, maybe I just need to give it more time. It just doesn't do it for me, but, you know, good record. Gangland is the fucking track, for sure. Hellbound's no slumper either. Slumper? Whatever. Getting into the vinyl. A heavy release for me in more ways than one. The confusingly self-titled St. Vitus record. There's another St. Vitus record that's self-titled. Their very first, I believe. This is a return of Scott Rieger's, which makes things even more confusing because he sang on that other one too. This is wonderful. I don't think St. Vitus could ever do wrong in my book. I'm a bit of a super fan. I don't pre-order things often, but I did pre-order this from Seasons of Mist. It's got this beautiful kind of embossed silver thing going on. I saw the CD versions of it at Newbury the other day, and they're actually very similar. It's kind of a digipack with embossing, which looks nice as well. Cool gatefold. This one's just on black vinyl. The first side, it's perfect, Rieger St. Vitus. I think he's belting out the vocal performance of his career, in my opinion. He sounds really good. I'm not particularly mad at Decibel. I like some stuff they do. I dislike some stuff they do. some of their reviews, you know. It's nice to have a in-print metal magazine still around to pick up and read. I was a little bit annoyed with their review of this. The reviewer criticized Rieger's vocal, saying, does he have to put vibrato at the end of every single line of every single song? I found myself wondering if this guy, this reviewer, had listened to Rieger's St. Vitus, because this is how he sings. This is how he's always sang. And he sounds better on this than anything else. The last one he was on, he did more of like a strained, like evil sounding kind of thing. And on this, he's like, it sounds like he's got more of a range than he ever did, which is wonderful. The first song on the second side, Wormhole, came off as a little bit cheesy to me. It's like a lot of very on the nose references to older St. Vitus lyrics and song titles. This weird, this kind of groovy riff that's a little, was almost like a little bit too happy sounding to me. The song Hourglass, the song after it, also kind of didn't really sound like St. Vitus to me. Kind of sounded more almost like the bands they inspired, like Down and COC. And I love me some COC. I like Down okay, but you know, it's just not quite there for me, but it's still a good song. It's still head and shoulders above most new Doom for me, except for Consilium. And the last song, Useless, is like a rager fast hardcore punk song, which is great. Not the first fast song they did. They did Hollow's Victim, which was also kind of a thrasher of a song. But this song is really fast, and it sounds like Verbal Abuse or something like that. Very L.A., early 80s hardcore, which was a nice surprise. I wonder if there are people that are pissed that they have like a really fast song on this record. They do. They're straight up fools. Next we have Mall of Horrors by the Ouroboros Boys. This was a gift from my friend Nick. He plays in this band. Hype sticker says instrumental post-punk from North Carolina for fans of Brutalist, Architecture, and Pink Sunsets. This is really cool. Very soundtracky, almost like post-surf. You know, it's got elements of surf rock with like weird horror and sci-fi tinges to it. Nick plays electric mandolin and does sampling and noise on it, and piano. It's very, very cool stuff. It's a mellow record, but it's got a certain edgy kind of foreboding element to it. I will leave a link for the Bandcamp. If this sounds like something up your alley, I think it's great. It is sort of post-punk, and it's definitely surf-influenced, and dark and cool. Almanac of Human Horrors, Celestial Arena, A Sick and Clever Moon. Good song titles. So, this is part of my wedding merch haul. In addition to getting stuff from Paris from Consilium and Jason Hook, my good friend Mike Tommyrot, one of the finest gentlemen that I know, gave me a couple of LPs. This is the only one I've really listened to. I recognize this band's logo. I never really listened to them. They were in New York. Kind of thrash, kind of speed metal band called EXE. Stricken by Might is the name of the LP. They played thrash with class, apparently, according to the hype sticker. Great band photos on the back, too. This is awesome. It's produced by Alex Perialis, engineered by Alex Perialis, and produced by Carl Kennedy. So it's got 80s like Metal Blade style written all over it, and that's the sound too. I have a feeling if this came out in 83 on Metal Blade as opposed to 87 on whatever label this is on, Shatter Records, that this band might have been bigger. Like I said, I've seen the logo around. You know, you go digging on really obscure thrash and speed metal, you come across stuff like this, but I think it's kind of a shame that I've never really had this come across my path until now. It's very early Slayer, kind of, in the vocal department. A little bit more straightforward and not as thrashy. It's got a lot in common with a lot of that great early speed metal, American power metal, bleeding into thrash kind of stuff, like Exciter, Canadian, but bands like Exciter, bands like Savage Grace, you know, that sort of thing. There's only one song on this I didn't like. I think it was War Child on the second side that almost had like a cock-rocky AOR kind of chorus and seemed really out of place. But I would recommend this, you know, at least pulling it up on YouTube and checking it out. It's a gem for sure. Next up, a couple of records that I talked about last year that have gotten reissues. on Painkiller and their subsidiary Hell Massacre. First up, Big Cheese, UK hardcore band, very NYHC inspired. Vocalist is a dead ringer for Jeff Perlin from Breakdown. This compiles their Aggravated Mopery 7-inch and the Sports Day demo with one extra track from a demo session. I spoke about these guys at length when I talked about their records. It's a great love note to Where the Wild Things Are, New Breed Comp style, New York hardcore stuff. Vocals very Breakdown, but the music is a little bit more intricate and almost kind of like Absolution and Burn here and there. They can play their asses off. They've clearly done their homework with that style of hardcore, and you should buy this. I believe this is on a cool color. Nope, it's not. The next one's on a cool color. But it's a great insert there. Nice Raw Deal shirt. Printed insert. Painkiller Records, who are now distributed exclusively through Deathwish. So pretty easy to find that stuff and get it to your house quick. And next up, one of my favorite death slash grind records from last year. Theater of Morbidity by Bone Sickness. This did come on the cool color. My brain farted, which was which. Nice green. This came out on Hell Massacre, which is the sub-label of Painkiller, their death metal label. Awesome fucking Repulsion and Slaughter Worship with a little bit of punk in there, a little bit more punk than the aforementioned, maybe a little bit of power violence. Lots of sound clips. Fun ones, though, that are quick and to the point and actually enhance the music. There was a little little skipping. I think it's a pressing error on the first side, but it really didn't detract. It was only through the opening sound clip, so it didn't really bother me. But I don't know if that issue's been addressed or whatever, but fucking great. Great album. I have the tape, too. One of my favorites from 2018. Patrons of the Dark by Paralysis up next. Early 90s death metal from... God, the glare is terrible. Let me see if I can fix that. All right, that's a little bit better. Glare was in the forecast today. Heavy clouds, temperature of approximately 73, and glare all over Pat's video. Patrons of the Dark by Paralysis. Originally came out on Grindcore Records in 92. Morbid Generation Records re-released it. I originally was reminded of this by Trez, who talked about it as one of his most influential records getting into as a kid. And I was like, you know, I need to check that out. I know it's early, like, proto-brutal with two O's kind of death metal stuff. And I like that stuff a lot, like early Suffocation. Not so into where that music went, you know, by the end of the 90s. But any really, really early examples of that kind of really brutal sound I like. Early Internal Bleeding, too. And this is awesome because it's got a lot of density to it and a very obscure... almost kind of foggy production, clean bass sound, very shadowy sounding, and of course very, you know, brutal, heavy, and almost kind of slamming. The vocalist is one of the guys that went on to like Goat Horror, and before that was in Soylent Green. But this is a great piece of wax, and yeah, gotta love that classical artwork there. Classical paintings. Next up, we got Gorelust from Canada. They were a Quebecois, also kind of early brutal death metal band. Almost comes off as kind of a Cryptopsy Junior to me. You know, a lot of stop on the dime kind of technicality to it, a lot of blasting, very busy drums, and very fucking good. I believe there's a member of Cryptopsy who actually guests on one of the songs on here, which is a cover of Pleasure to Kill, no, cover of Extreme Aggression by Creator. Yeah, this is also recommended. Just very, very concise, sharp, technical, brutal as fuck, guttural death metal stuff from our neighbors to the north. Also, I'd say early Suffocation probably fits in there with it. And you gotta love this artwork. I mean, it's a piano where there's a corpse and a pentagram. Sweet. Oh, next. Hellbastard. Heading for Internal Darkness. This is a reissue. So during my deep dive of all this UK hardcore, which kind of includes a lot of the early crust stuff, getting into back into stuff like Prophecy of Doom and Axe Grinder and Deviated Instinct, I knew I needed some Hellbastard. So I got myself some Hellbastard. this is their, you know, classic LP. They've done a bunch since then. Their second LP was actually very speed metal, and I like that too, Natural Order. But this is perfect for that early crust stuff. You know, it kind of helped define the sound, taking the Amoebics influence and bringing it in with some faster thrashing, inspired no doubt by metal, speed metal, and thrash metal. There's also like a good amount of like kind of morose anarcho-punk in there. A lot of, there's some female spoken word and singing and like that sort of anti-sect vibe going on. But yeah, great, great fucking album. This came out on a bunch of labels, it looks like. Self-released by Hellbastard and Threat from the Past. Nervous Impulse. So, I don't do the blind boxes very often. Once in a while, I'll get an itch to be like, oh, it's $30 for a bunch of mystery LPs. I don't do that often because I'm a control freak and I like to be able to, you know what I'm getting. You know, I don't really like rolling the dice unless it's with a label that has a very focused musical base. For some reason, I don't know if I hit my head and didn't realize it, I was like, oh, Bridge Nine's having a mystery box sale. They had releases I liked 20 years ago. Let me order the Bridge Nine mystery box. They put out a bunch of good stuff recently, but I forgot that they had this period where they were putting out stuff like Boy Sets Fire and Crime and Stereo, two of the bands that I received records by, and it's just not my scene. I don't hate it. Like, those bands can play well or whatever, but not my tastes. But I did get this. This is Nervous Impulse, project band from Virginia or DC. I know it's got members of Strike Anywhere who are from Richmond, if I'm not mistaken, so probably from there. And it's very cool, like political. Bad Brains worship, more or less. You know, Bad Brains, very early Cro-Mags. Got that super energetic, very adept musicianship going on. Hardcore punk. Fast songs with a lot to bite into in terms of just, like, quick changes and stop on a dime kind of energy. So, yeah, if you like early Bad Brains and the first Cro-Mags record, I'd say check this out. It's probably cheap. Nervous Impulse came out, like, 5 years ago or something. Couple of records that Jason brought me at the wedding. Red Death, Formidable Darkness. I also talked about this like a year or two ago, a while back when it came out. I had the CD, and Jason was nice enough to give me the wax. Haven't listened to it in a minute, but this band's really, really good. They're excellent live. They also have some sort of similarities to Cro-Mags, I feel like, leaning more in a crossover direction. I feel like they easily fit in that newer mold of modern crossover with Power Trip and Foreseen and the like, Enforced, but they are more hardcore than those bands. There's more of a straightforward hardcore bass with the metal. You know, fast and thrashy still, though, and excellent. All their material's good. They have another LP and a 7-inch, I think, right now. I think they're going to be releasing something new pretty soon. Share members with Protester, who are also great, DC straight edge band. Formidable Darkness. So this is the Stick Together LP. This I did not have. Jason gave me this as well. And it's fucking awesome. I'm kind of apprehensive when it comes to a lot of straightforward, fast, hardcore, leaning towards sort of the youth crew realm, I guess. It can get real generic and real boring. This isn't like that at all. Straight edge band with some songwriting fucking chops behind them and extremely tight playing. Nice little homage to Blood, Sweat, and No Tears by Sick of It All, by the way. Printed in her sleeve there. Yeah, very quick record, as it should be, you know, 15, 20 minutes. Definitely not metallic or thrashy like Red Death, but they have that ultra tight, great at playing their instruments kind of thing. Oop, download code. Tight playing kind of thing where they almost become metal by default, if you know what I mean. Very good at like riding the E and stuff like that, but just, yeah, vacuum sealed, fucking tight, angry straight edge hardcore. I think they're from PA. Really fucking good. And then finally, pick this up. Only thing I didn't own by Disassociate I was happy to pick this up when I saw them live, playing with I Hate God, Sheer Terror, and Negative Approach. It was a hell of a gig. And this is their second LP, Symbols, Signals, and Noise. Disassociate are a, I guess you could call them a grind band. It plays heavily in the DIY punk scene. Been around since the 90s. All their records are good. They're all pretty similar in sound. They have this interesting mesh of grind with blasting and almost like power, I wouldn't say power electronics, but noisy elements to it, like blurred, blown out distortion, weird samples interspersed, but also really upbeat, like almost street punk catchiness to the a lot of the choruses and everything. Deep growled, like straight up grind or death metal vocals. Been doing what they've been doing for a very, very long time, and they were great live, and it was awesome finally seeing them. I'd always wanted to see them back in the day. They're always kind of tied in, we're always kind of tied in with the 90s crust scene, and I feel like they were kind of stuck out, you know, maybe not necessarily like a sore thumb, but they stuck out because they really could play very well, and they had a considerably more kind of musical ability than most bands that they played with, other than maybe Phobia. But at any rate, Symbols, Signals, and Noise, great record. All their records are worth your time. And this came out on World Grind Federation, it's a great name for a music label there, record label. All right, well, that's enough rambling. On with my week. More updates to come, as always. I hope everyone has a wonderful work week.